Good morning and welcome to the Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee hearing of Energy and Commerce titled Counterfeit Drugs, Fighting Illegal Supply Chains. This hearing could also be titled Poison Pills in Your Medicine Cabinet or Counterfeiters Deliver Deadly Drugs. And it states it's to the fact that we need to examine the growing problem of counterfeit drugs in our country. Last year, Congress took an important first step against this threat by enacting the new track and trace law known as the Drug Quality and Security Act of 2013. This new law will secure the legitimate distribution channels and when implemented will solve the legal supply chain part of the counterfeit drug problem. However, many Americans purchase medicines through illegal supply chains, such as rogue internet pharmacies and other black markets. It is that part of the counterfeit drug threat that we address today. This hearing focuses on the illegal supply chains of counterfeit drugs and on efforts to deter and disrupt these illegal supply chains. The legitimate U.S. drug supply is safe, but counterfeit drugs from illegal sources are a significant and growing global public health threat, potentially causing treatment failure or death and contributing to increased antimicrobial resistance. The policy of the United States government is not to wait for a full-blown crisis before taking appropriate action. Drug counterfeiters do not just steal intellectual property. They recklessly and intentionally endanger human lives. They sell counterfeits that do not contain active ingredients and provide no treatment benefit to the patient. Thus, a child suffering from malaria who takes a fake anti-malaria drug might die within 48 hours because the malaria remains untreated. The counterfeiters sell fakes that may contain incorrect ingredients, improper dosages, hazardous or poisonous ingredients. For example, an emergency room doctor from Texas in 2011 took a counterfeit weight loss drug he bought from an online pharmacy. The drug was contaminated with a controlled substance and he suffered a stroke. The counterfeiters sell drugs with risks for harmful side effects or allergic reactions. For example, in 2007 and 2008, dozens of heart surgery and kidney dialysis patients in the United States suffered unexpected allergic-like reactions and several lost their lives due to intentionally contaminated heparin imported from China that had entered the Chinese heparin supply before purporting to be pure heparin. The counterfeiters do not care about the patients who were hurt. One counterfeiter, Richard Taylor, was notified in May 2011 that two patients who had been on a counterfeit cancer drug he had distributed had started to shake in the middle of being transfused and had to be disconnected from treatment. However, the penalties for drug counterfeiters under the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act have not been updated since 1938. As the FDA commissioner has said, there is a steeper penalty for counterfeiting a designer purse under the Federal Criminal Code than a drug product under current FDA law. Drug counterfeiting is highly profitable, and the criminals only face the maximum penalties under the FDA law of $10,000 or 3 years in prison. In contrast, penalties for trafficking narcotics can have prison sentences up to life and fines in the millions of dollars. There's one estimate that the return on counterfeit drugs may be 10 times greater than that of the sale of illegal narcotics. Now, experts tell us that the counterfeit drug problem has worsened over the last decade, and the reason for this disturbing trend include increasing opportunities created by larger, more complex supply chains, more customers reachable through the internet, more cases where the counterfeiting crimes occur in several countries, making enforcement more difficult, and the expansion of counterfeiting from so-called lifestyle drugs into therapeutic medicines used to treat cancer, heart disease, or other illnesses. The illegal supply chains are numerous and global. Rogue internet pharmacies are now proliferating. There are believed to be about 35,000 to 50,000 active online sellers, 97% of which do not comply with U.S. laws. According to one review of over 10,000 internet sites, one report estimated that one in six Americans, 36 million people, have bought medicines online without a valid prescription. These illegal pharmacy operations are big business, with the largest ones reportedly making $1 to $2.5 million of sales each month. The sheer volume of imported drugs in the U.S. is overwhelming, and opportunities have never been greater for foreign unapproved drugs to get into the United States. Nearly 40% of drugs taken by Americans are made overseas, and 80% of the active ingredients are imported from about 3,800 foreign manufacturers in more than 150 countries. According to a 2011 FDA report, the number of foreign drug suppliers has doubled in the last 7 years. The Government Accountability Office has found FDA is only able to inspect foreign drug plants every 9 years, while FDA inspects domestic drug manufacturers every 2 years. Well, the subcommittee will also examine other illegal supply chains, such as medical clinics and doctors who purchase drugs from illegal sources, business-to-business networks, and smugglers bringing unapproved or counterfeit drugs from Mexico into the U.S. I welcome all of today's outstanding witnesses. I look forward to your testimony, and now I turn to recognize my friend and ranking member, Ms. DeGette of Colorado.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I really appreciate you having this hearing. We had a number of hearings some years ago in this committee on drug counterfeiting, and it was shocking and appalling to see how serious this problem is. While we did pass that great bill last year, still I think that drug counterfeiting is a terrible problem that we need to address in a bipartisan fashion. As you said, counterfeit drugs can contain dangerous impurities, incorrect ingredients, improper dosages, and also have improper handling. And legitimate drugs have been diverted or stolen from the supply chain, and they've been handled improperly or stored at the wrong temperature. And then, of course, these fraudsters spend a lot of time recreating labels and packaging for the dangerous drug so that they look exactly like the real thing. I got some samples today. These are Lipitor samples, and they look exactly the same. The blister packs are the same. The pills are exactly the same. The alleged dosages are exactly the same. And if you ordered these online, you would think that you were getting Lipitor. But however, which one is the real and which one is the fake? You couldn't possibly tell, except for there's a label on the package. Here's the fake, and here's the real. And this is what these counterfeiters do. They spend more time worrying about what the packaging is going to look like so it will fool the consumer, and a lot less time worrying about whether there's actual medication inside that's going to help people. We've seen a number of troubling cases recently. Criminals have tampered with pharmaceuticals used to treat illnesses like cancer and HIV/AIDS. Drugs used to treat schizophrenia were replaced with aspirin. Counterfeit cancer drugs were tainted with non-sterile tap water, and counterfeit AIDS drugs have been found to lack any ingredient. And as you said, the internet is really especially problematic for these unsafe drugs. And according to a recent FDA survey, approximately 1 in 4 Americans has purchased prescription drugs online. Most consumers purchase drugs from reputable businesses, but there are thousands of rogue internet pharmacies, some of which you couldn't tell from just looking on site, that sell drugs of dubious quality without a prescription. I couldn't believe it that you said that there was a doctor who bought these drugs online. I mean, surely if anybody should know, it should be a doctor. Now, Congress passed the Ryan Height Act in 2008, and then last year, as you said, the Drug Quality and Security Act, which provide additional enforcement tools. And so I'm eager to hear from the GAO whether these laws have had an impact in combating this problem and what more can be done. I'm also interested to learn from the stakeholders and the agencies how we can increase awareness and education in the medical community and the public more broadly about the prevalence of and risks associated with counterfeit drugs. I must say, I talk to my constituents, and people assume if they're buying drugs from a pharmacy online that it would be safe. And that's an incorrect assumption to make. I think we need to have partnerships between the pharmaceutical companies, between government agencies, between nonprofit agencies, and a variety of sources to let people know how dangerous it can be to buy drugs from an internet source. And I want to commend the FDA, ICE, and the other federal agencies for their work in protecting consumers from unsafe drugs. But I also want to learn more about what we can do about counterfeiting drug activity and whether we need more authorities or stricter penalties to effectively carry out this work. Globally, the FDA works with World Health Organization and Interpol to build global capacity to monitor counterfeit drugs and to coordinate international law enforcement action. And so I know that our witness from the University of Michigan, Dr. Yadav, will talk about the global health implications of counterfeit drug activity and how existing international efforts can be strengthened. Prosecuting these wrongdoers is difficult because they're shady and they're international. But I think if we have domestic and international partnerships, we can do it. Consumers should never have to fear the prescription drug they need may actually make them sick or endanger the lives of their loved ones. And so that's why these partnerships are critical. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses and continuing to work together to make sure that when a consumer buys a drug, they know that it's going to be safe. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize the Vice Chairman of the Committee, Dr. Burgess, for 5 minutes.
I thank the Chairman for the recognition. I thank our witnesses for being here. Terribly important hearing that we're having this morning. Let me begin my statement with a quote. The market for prescription drugs has been the catalyst for a continuing series of frauds against American manufacturers and has provided cover for counterfeit drugs. The effect of these practices and conditions is to create an unacceptable risk that counterfeit, adulterated, misbranded, subpotent, or expired drugs will be sold to American consumers. Now, you might think I'm reading from today's hearing memo, but in fact, they were from the findings of the Prescription Drug Marketing Act of 1987. That bipartisan law was a result of a series of hearings conducted with Chairman Dingell in this very subcommittee. In the report accompanying the bill from 1987, this subcommittee found, again quoting, American consumers cannot purchase prescription drugs with the certainty that the products are safe and effective. This is not to say that the shelves of the nation's pharmacies are lined with substandard products or that there are inadequate controls in the manufacturing process. Rather, the integrity of the distribution system is insufficient to prevent the introduction and the eventual retail sale of substandard, ineffective, or even counterfeit pharmaceuticals. Again, quoting from the findings in 1987. The United States has the best drug supply chain in the world, and this committee's work has been long and notable, and medications have become more advanced. Our supply chain has become more global in its reach. The equally consistent and sophisticated attacks each and every day by counterfeiters, rogue distributors, and those willing to adulterate products and put patients at risk are no less today than they were in 1987. According to the World Health Organization, in 2010, worldwide counterfeit medicine sales topped $75 billion. That was almost doubling in 5 years, and some speculate the number will continue to grow by 20% each year. At its most extreme, these criminals are willing to literally risk patients' lives to sell counterfeits. As a doctor, such immorality of knowingly sentencing a patient to death by either denying them treatment or selling them an adulterated product, that is an absolutely chilling proposition. In my opinion, punishment for counterfeiting prescription medications is so far from adequate as to be laughable. From fake flu vaccines to oncology drugs, counterfeit medications have been able to enter the supply chain and, in fact, administered to patients. Detecting counterfeit drugs is difficult, if not impossible. There is no field test that we can send people out to perform to indicate whether a drug is fake or real, and even the trained experts are often unable to detect whether a drug is what it purports to be. Counterfeit and other adulterated drugs present an unreasonable risk to Americans. Thankfully, this subcommittee, has remained vigilant, and I believe the passage of the Drug Quality and Security Act last year will provide a valuable tool. Some will argue it took too long, but nevertheless, it does tighten our distribution system. While our system may be the best in the world, our healthcare workforce does not have the confidence that they should have that the drugs they are dispensing or administering are the ones that came from the manufacturer. I will also note that a December 2005 report found that nearly half of the imported drugs the Food and Drug Administration intercepted from 4 selected countries to fill orders placed with firms that consumers thought were Canadian, in fact, 85% came from 27 other countries around the globe. A number of these products were also found to be counterfeit. Just as a practical matter, I will never forget the day in my practice back in North Texas when the story broke that fake oral contraceptives had been introduced into the market. Our phones melted down that morning, and many anxious patients spent many anxious hours trying to determine if they had the pill or the lot number from the the inappropriate counterfeit pills and whether or not they would have the potency to provide the protection they were purported to provide. Maintaining the integrity of the United States prescription drug supply is a compelling national priority and requires national solutions involving business, healthcare providers, and governments coming together and being vigilant in the face of threats. The vigilance of this committee, this subcommittee, has been established in the past and continues today. Thank the chairman for the recognition. I'll yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back now. Recognize the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Waxman, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased that we're having an important oversight hearing where the 20 minutes so far into the opening statements, no one has blamed the problem on President Obama. This is rare for this committee. But we are doing the job that we should be doing because the entry of counterfeit drugs into our drug supply chain poses a grave public health threat. Time and again, we've read stories about patients getting drugs from internet pharmacies or even their doctors or local pharmacies that were unsafe or ineffective counterfeits or that were stolen and not stored properly, so they no longer worked. We have taken legislative steps on a bipartisan basis to address this problem. In 2012, we passed the Bipartisan FDA Safety and Innovation Act, or FDASIA. The law requires companies to notify FDA of drug thefts and counterfeit or adulterated drugs that could cause serious harm. It requires manufacturers and importers to register annually with the FDA and provide unique facility identifiers so that FDA knows who and where they are. It bans imports of drugs from foreign facilities that delay, deny, or limit FDA inspection. And it enhances criminal penalties for intentionally counterfeiting or adulterating a drug in a way that could cause serious adverse health consequences. Last year, we passed the Bipartisan Drug Quality and Security Act. This law gives the FDA and industry new tools to deter, discover, and remedy the entry of illegal drugs into the supply chain. However, the legislation was not designed for sophisticated criminal enterprises intent on evading the law, and the most useful of the new tools, an electronic unit-level tracking and tracing system, is not required to be in place until 2023. So it's hard to reach a conclusion other than more needs to be done. Today, the government has to prove an intent to violate the law before it can even win a criminal case, and even then the maximum penalty for some violations with potentially life-threatening consequences is only 3 years. We need a stronger, surer deterrent. We also need to consider what to do about the fact that so many of our drugs are sourced from abroad. This can create serious drug safety and security issues. In India, where FDA inspections have tripled since FDASIA, FDA is finding serious lapses in quality. And as the New York Times reported recently, even India's top drug regulator concedes that most of the drug facilities supplying the domestic Indian market do not meet FDA standards. This is a serious problem because India is the second largest exporter of drugs to the U.S., supplying 40% of our generic and over-the-counter drugs. In China, the U.S. government had to negotiate for almost a full year just to get visas for the additional inspectors that FDA needs to conduct more frequent and timely inspections. It could put much of our drug supply at risk because the crucial ingredients for nearly all antibiotics, steroids, and many other life-saving drugs are now made exclusively in China. Well, Mr. Chairman, I look forward to the hearing from our witnesses today, and I thank you for holding this important hearing. It is appropriate, it's legitimate, it is what Oversight Committee should be doing, and I hope it's a first step towards passing legislation that will effectively deter and punish those who put Americans' health at risk with counterfeit pharmaceuticals. And I want to say in my closing minute, Mr. Chairman, unfortunately there's another subcommittee meeting at the same time, so I will be in and out of this hearing, but will review the testimony of the witnesses that will be making a presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Waxman. Yields back. I'd now like to introduce our witnesses on the first panel for today's hearing. We do have two panels of distinguished people. First, Mr. Howard Sklamberg, do I have that correct? Is the Deputy Commissioner for Global Regulatory Operations and Policy for the Food and Drug Administration. I'd like to note that due to the amount of exhibits the FDA would like to show in support of the testimony, both sides agreed to allow Mr. Sklamberg 10 minutes for his oral testimony instead of the usual five. And Mr. Lev Kubiak, welcome, is the Director of the National Intellectual Property Rights Coordination Center for the Department of Homeland Security's Immigration and Customs Enforcement. I'm now swearing the witnesses. You are aware that the committee is holding an investigative hearing, and when doing so, has had the practice of taking testimony under oath. Do either of you object to testifying under oath? The chair then advises you that under the rules of the House and rules of the committee, you are entitled to be advised by counsel. Do you either of you desire to be advised by counsel during the testimony today? Thank you. In that case, would you please rise and raise your right hand, and I'll swear you in. Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you. Both witnesses answer in the affirmative. You are now under oath and subject to the penalties set forth in Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. Mr. Sklamberg, you may now give your opening statement and video.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the subcommittee. I'm Howard Sklamberg, Deputy Commissioner for Global Regulatory Operations and Policy at the Food and Drug Administration, and thank you for this opportunity to be here today to discuss the important issue of counterfeit drugs. Counterfeit drugs raise significant public health concerns. A counterfeit drug could be made using ingredients that are toxic to patients and processed under poorly controlled and unsanitary conditions. In the United States, a relatively comprehensive system of laws, regulations, and enforcement by federal and state authorities has kept drug counterfeiting incidents in the U.S. relatively rare. FDA continues to believe and works to ensure that Americans can have a high degree of confidence in the drugs they obtain through legal channels. Nonetheless, with the dramatic increase in the complexity of the global supply chain, we face enormous challenges regarding supply chain security. FDA is not alone in its effort to address the problem of counterfeit drugs, and I want to note the efforts of my colleague on this panel and on the other panels and their work on this problem as well. Growth in counterfeiting may be spurred by several things, including the increasing volume of drugs, longer supply chains, the development of technologies that make it easier to counterfeit drugs, and the involvement of international organized crime. This growth also is exacerbated by the relatively low criminal penalties for distribution of adulterated, unapproved, or misbranded drugs under the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act compared to other types of crime. In addition, the internet presents another layer of complexity by introducing more players and more opportunities for criminals to reach consumers. The global anonymity of the internet can provide a safe haven for illicit prescription drug sales. Many websites lead unsuspecting customers in the U.S. to believe the dispensing pharmacy is in the U.S. or Canada. FDA has made it a priority to investigate reports of counterfeit products. As part of these efforts, FDA's Office of Criminal Investigations, or OCI, aggressively investigates reports of counterfeit products in order to protect U.S. citizens. OCI's investigations have led to some notable successes. I'd like to provide some examples from our investigations. The first is from an investigation into Counterfeit Ally, and would the clerk please pull up the Ally video?
你把房子躲开了吗？来，先进来。来。这小子，你走过去看看，有一个箱子。进去。 你写给他啊，可以，可以先写。嗯，行。等等，你等以后再慢慢打，记不清了，不懂。
Thank you. And would the clerk please load picture one? And as it's being loaded, the picture shows a refrigerator used to store illegally imported, adulterated, and misbranded prescription drugs that were smuggled into the U.S. These drugs were discovered in the home of a repacker who would subsequently ship the drugs to doctors throughout the U.S. Would the clerk please load picture two? One of the ways some traffickers obtain prescription drugs is to buy them from customers of various pharmacies whose medications were paid for by Medicaid. In order to be able to reuse the bottle with the original label, they would have to clean the pharmacy label and the Medicaid sticker off of the label using things such as lighter fluid. Where we have observed bottle washing with a solvent, we generally observe chemicals in the solvent that have migrated through the bottle onto the drug. Would the clerk please load picture three? It would, well, through the particular bottle, I'm not sure in the instances what type of bottle it is, but we can get back to you on that. But it would be, it is common for things to migrate through plastic. Would the clerk please load picture three? The following photos were taken from a Belize-based manufacturing facility involved in selling unapproved prescription drugs and controlled substances. The pills from the trash cans in this picture were transferred into plastic bags to be counted and bagged by using a scoop. The same scoop was used for many different drugs, including controlled drugs. This led to cross-contamination. Would the clerk please load picture four? This picture shows some of the conditions at the manufacturing facility. Would the clerk please load picture five? This picture shows the condition of the tablet room at the facility. I want to show a comparison of what a legitimate tablet press should look like. Would the clerk please load picture six so you can see the difference? FDA has been working with industry and international partners to develop new methods to address the problem of counterfeit drugs. FDA scientists have developed and have been testing a counterfeit detection device, CD3, at U.S. ports of entry and elsewhere for use by FDA investigators to check for suspect counterfeit products. CD3, which I'm now holding, is a battery-operated, handheld, and inexpensive tool that costs a fraction of the price of existing laboratory-based and field-deployed technologies. Would the clerk please play the CD3 video?
...of wavelengths of light. Because different substances reflect light differently, CD3 instantly shows whether a product is authentic or not.
So as you're pressing the buttons, you're looking for different features on the packaging or on the product. Either the product will glow or the packaging will glow in a different way, or different features within the packaging will emit or absorb light differently.
To the naked eye, you may not be able to see anything, but CD3 sees. Clear differences can be detected between these capsules. On the right is the real thing.
Now, it is important to note that while this technology is helpful, it will not solve the problem, particularly given the volume of products that come through ports of entry. FDA also participates in Operation Pangea, which is a global cooperative effort in partnership with international regulatory and law enforcement agencies to combat the online sale and distribution of potentially dangerous counterfeit and illegal medical products. As part of the 2013 annual effort, the partnership took action against more than 13,700 websites illegally selling potentially dangerous unapproved prescription medicines to customers. These actions included the issuance of regulatory warnings and the seizure of offending websites of and over $36 million worth of illegal medicines worldwide. FDA, in coordination with the U.S. Attorney's Office for the District of Colorado, seized and shut down 1,677 illegal pharmacy websites. The case of Manuel Calvello illustrates the inherently international and thus difficult to prosecute nature of the internet pharmacy investigations. Calvello is a Belgian citizen operating in a global internet pharmacy with a call center in the Philippines and a credit processor in the Netherlands. Calvello's websites offered for sale more than 40 prescription drugs, such as Viagra, Glucophage, Zoloft, Lipitor, Cialis, Xanax, Ativan, and Klonopin. Note that Xanax, Ativan, and Klonopin are controlled substances. OCI was able to arrest Calvello in Costa Rica and extradite him to the U.S. after an extended undercover operation in which OCI agents posed as pharmaceutical wholesalers seeking to do business with him. Public education is very important as a first-line defense against counterfeit drugs. The agency is conducting proactive educational outreach to the medical community and other stakeholders. In September 2012, FDA launched a national campaign called Be Safe RX, Know Your Online Pharmacy. Be Safe RX provides resources for patients and caregivers who might purchase prescription drugs online to enable them to better understand who they are buying from and to help ensure the drugs they buy match the product the doctor prescribed. The Food and Drug Administration Safety and Innovation Act, or FDASIA, enacted in July 2012, provided the agency with new authorities that will help to secure the safety and integrity of drugs imported into and sold in the U.S. For example, the law provides FDA with the authority to administratively detain drugs believed to be adulterated or misbranded, and the authority to destroy certain adulterated, misbranded, or counterfeit drugs offered for import. The law also requires foreign and domestic companies to provide complete information on threats to the security of the drug supply chain and to improve current registration and listing information. The recently enacted Drug Quality and Security Act outlines critical steps to build an electronic and operable system to identify and trace certain prescription drugs. Within 10 years after enactment, the system will facilitate the exchange of information at the individual package level about where a drug has been in the supply chain. While the new authorities under FDASIA and the DQSA help address some of the risks posed by counterfeit drugs, they will not prevent all types of illegal diversion or distribution schemes. These laws would not prevent the numerous instances FDA has uncovered of medical practitioners deliberately obtaining unapproved drugs, some of which have been counterfeits directly from foreign sources for administering to patients. The reality is that the criminal penalty under the Food, Drug, Cosmetic Act for the risky and inherently dangerous practice of importing unapproved foreign drugs is simply not sufficient to deter the criminal element. The penalty for such conduct, which generally falls under the misbranding and unapproved new drugs provisions of the FD&C Act, is 3 years imprisonment, and then only if the government can show there is a specific intent to defraud or mislead. Otherwise, it is a misdemeanor, punishable only by a maximum of 1 year of imprisonment. The Ryan Haight Act also sets forth, for the first time under federal law, the definition of a valid prescription with regard to controlled substances. Many online pharmacies, however, sell prescription drugs that are not controlled substances. These drug sales are regulated under the FD&C Act and require a valid prescription, but the FD&C Act does not define what constitutes a valid prescription. In the online pharmacy context, where numerous doctors and their respective customers are often located in different states, this can complicate criminal prosecution under the FD&C Act. Given the challenges and threats posed by an increasingly globalized marketplace, it is important that FDA, regulatory and law enforcement partners, and industry continue to work together to address the problem and threat of counterfeit drugs, and that we continue to ensure authorities keep pace with the complex system that counterfeiters and traffickers take advantage of. We look forward to continuing to work together to achieve our shared goal of protecting American consumers. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Slammer. Mr. Kubiak, we're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Murphy, Ranking Member DeGette, and distinguished subcommittee members. Thank you very much for this opportunity to speak today about the efforts of ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, and the center that I run, the National Intellectual Property Rights Center. I currently serve as the director of that center. It's led by ICE, and the center operates as a task force model comprised of 21 federal and international partners, including FDA, which I'm pleased to join today here on this panel. It is this collection of agencies partnered together, pooling resources, expertise, and authorities that makes the IPR Center truly unique and effective. No subset of agencies has the individual capacity or capability to address the significant and growing threat of IP crime alone. The center optimizes the effectiveness of each agency and provides a single location for industry collaboration and reporting. Next slide, or can you put the second slide up, please? I'm sorry. As the picture that you're about to see illustrates, our biggest challenge right now is that criminals now counterfeit effectively and effectively market virtually any product with no regard to the public's health and safety, be it exploding airbags, as is represented on the right hand of that scene, to counterfeit industrial bearings used in mine shafts and mining equipment, to drugs without active ingredient. The callous nature of counterfeiting results in dangerous, even deadly outcomes. Another significant challenge we face is while ocean crossing shipping containers are necessary for the bulk movement of quantities of counterfeit items like handbags, batteries, or razor blades, other high-value items, including counterfeit pharmaceuticals and semiconductors used by our United States military, are being smuggled in thousands of smaller packages through mail and express courier packages. Next slide, please. As this slide shows, the internet poses yet another significant challenge. Criminals operating unregulated websites providing counterfeit pharmaceuticals continue to be a growing global phenomenon. In April 2013, LegitScript, an online pharmacy verification service, stated that there were over 34,000 active rogue internet pharmacies selling substandard, counterfeit, or harmful prescription drugs. The screenshot you see here is from an actual criminal website that we seized as one of the 686 websites seized as a result of Operation Bitter Pill, a worldwide operation run by ICE through the IPR Center, targeting the online sale of counterfeit illegal medicine. This website was run by a criminal organization based overseas and purported, as you can see, to be a Canadian, legitimate Canadian healthcare facility. With this type of ambiguity, consumer fraud can run rampant. Next slide, please. Bless you. In early 2010, law enforcement authorities from the United Kingdom provided FDA information on an intercepted shipment of unapproved oncology drugs. The package, derived from Pakistan, was destined for California. Together, ICE, FDA, FBI, the U.S. Postal Service, and Customs and Border Protection collaborated on the investigation, discovering that Martin Paul Bean of Florida ordered the unapproved drugs from foreign sources in Turkey, India, and Pakistan, and then sold those drugs to doctors in the U.S. at substantially reduced prices. In September, Bean was sentenced to 2 years incarceration for distributing more than $7 million worth of unapproved and misbranded oncology drugs through his illicit pharmaceutical scheme, significant harm caused by just one criminal. This case example in the slide on the screen illustrates our strategy, which is to attack the criminal network throughout the entire global supply chain, from the point of manufacturer through shippers of illegal commodities to those that distribute the illegal drugs to unsuspecting people in need of effective medicine. This strategy requires a robust collaboration through our attaché network with foreign counterparts, where the majority of counterfeit items are made and through which they are transshipped en route to the United States and our trading partners worldwide. I know we are not going to be able to arrest and seize our way out of this growing problem, and that's why the IPR Center has committed significant effort to close collaboration with industry and education of the public. I do believe that we can reduce demand through education, and also believe that this is the most critical component of any long-term viable solution. Next slide, please. As part of our robust public education efforts, we have developed the IPR Center website, which includes information on efforts of all of our partner agencies and where they can report IP crime through our Report IP Theft button. Industry and other U.S. government agencies have joined the fight by placing the Report IP Theft button on their websites as well, now totaling more than 100 industry and embassy websites worldwide, including this one from the Pharmaceutical Security Institute, pictured in the screen. New leads to the center have increased nearly 500% since fiscal year 2012 as a result of this. I encourage the members of this committee to visit our website, and I invite you to place our Report IP Theft button on your page as well. Recently, we had Congressman Green visit the center himself, and we're working with his staff to do just that for his constituents. And I also welcome other members of this committee to visit the center. It's one thing to hear about it, it's another to see it, and we're just across the river in Crystal City. Once again, thank you very much for the opportunity to appear before you today, and I'm pleased to answer any questions you may have at this time.
Well, I thank both witnesses today for giving us some honest and solid and somewhat chilling testimony of this huge public health risk. Mr. Schlamberg, in your video, you showed Ally, that drug there. I'd referenced something in my opening statement about an emergency room doctor in Texas ordering this drug from a rogue internet pharmacy. Was that the same pharmacy, do you know?
I don't believe it was the same one.
But he suffered a stroke, is that correct?
Yes, you know? The one you're referring to, Mr. Chairman.
And unfortunately, he wasn't alone. I mean, many, many Americans, there's dozens of cases of death or serious injury suffered from these counterfeit, unapproved drugs from these rogue internet pharmacy sites. Is that
correct? That's correct. And in fact, what the illnesses that we know about would severely understate what's actually happening, because as you pointed out, Mr. Chairman, and some of your colleagues have, a lot of times the patients who are receiving these drugs are already quite sick. So if you're receiving, if you're taking Avastin and you have cancer, the Avastin, let's say it's counterfeit and let's say it completely doesn't work, it has no active ingredients, you may well end up dying from your cancer. The doctor who's giving you the Avastin might not know that in fact the Avastin was counterfeit and might think that you had died from your cancer despite getting real Avastin. And so it's very hard to establish the cause and effect. So what instances we have, we think severely actually understate the effect and the problem.
Thank you. Are you aware that National Association of Boards of Pharmacy and Logistics indicate that 97% of online pharmacies are actually rogue websites that operate in violation of federal law?
Yes, I've seen that statistic. The number of them is astonishing. I believe the GAO report as well has a rather astonishing.
And my understanding is when they don't require any prescription, that number may go closer to 100%.
It would go up.
You're aware that according to the report from the Partnership for DrugFree.org, 1 in 6 Americans, or 36 million people, have bought medication online without a valid prescription.
Yes.
And then given that all this, would it be fair to conclude there are probably millions and millions of Americans right now who have it in their purse, in their medicine cabinet, in their pocket, some significant safety risk of some medication that they may be taking today?
There are millions of Americans now who may very well have a medication that could, what they think is a medication, but that in reality could make them very sick.
I mean, I just while I'm asking these questions, I went into some online pharmacy and there's cancer drugs here and hypertension and psychiatric drugs, et cetera. I can just tap a button here, buy these, no one's asking me any questions, and I would assume that none of that is helpful. So this is really a major public health nightmare.
It is a major and growing problem.
Could the CD3 device the FDA has developed be made available to pharmacies or clinical settings or other areas to help spot counterfeit drugs?
Right now, it's still in the early stages. We developed it a short time ago. We have something like about 25 of them now. There are, to put the number in perspective, 1.2 million international mail entries in the United States every day. So we have about 25 of these. We're testing them. We're working on agreements with private industry to scale it up.
Yeah, please make sure that those aren't counterfeit.
Pardon me? Yes.
Make sure those devices.
No, this one's real. Good. But they're an important tool because they can do kind of a quick test. Mm-hmm. But they're not a panacea for two reasons. First of all, in terms of building a criminal law enforcement case, it catches what you think is counterfeit. If you're actually going to build a criminal case, you then have to test it and send it to a lab and, you know, mm-hmm. do that right, because the criminal law has standards for evidence that are, you know, often.
Well, there's also spectrometers that test the chemical content. We'll probably hear about that from the second
yes.
panel. Let me ask this. Heather Bresch, who's the CEO of Mylan Laboratories, which is headquartered in my district, has plants in the United States and India. And New York Times recently stated that the increased regulatory scrutiny in India was long overdue. Do you agree that we need to have greater scrutiny in places like India and China, and what are the concerns about counterfeit drugs specifically related to India?
Yeah, I would say that, you know, as the supply chain, both legitimate and counterfeit, grows and becomes more international, FDA has to step up its international presence, which is what we've been doing. So we've been using, for the legitimate supply chain, we've been using the tools that you gave us in FDASIA, for example. So ways of defining risk more clearly, ways of keeping drugs out, to keep drugs that are suspected of being adulterated out. We have increased foreign presence, increased number of foreign inspections, And that's part of the legitimate supply chain. We have to act aggressively in the legitimate supply chain when we encounter fraud that calls into question the integrity of the products, the integrity of the applications. And, of course, as the legitimate industry grows, there's also the illegitimate industry around the world that's growing. And what's happening that makes it, you know, particularly challenging us for us from a law enforcement perspective is it's no accident that in the counterfeit industry, it's developing in places where we do not have mutual legal assistance treaties, in places where we don't have extradition agreements. And it makes it harder for us to investigate those folks if they're in a country where we don't have the normal, we don't have the avenues of federal criminal law enforcement cooperation that we do in some other countries. So they're smart, they're careful, and what they're doing is evil. And so we have to, when we do catch them, be very aggressive and try to get penalties that will not only put the person in prison, but send a very, very strong message.
Thank you. I hope some other members will follow up and get some more details and recommendations for Congress. I'm out of time now. Turn to Ms. DeGette for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Sklamberg, I just want to ask you quickly. It sounds like the penalties are too low for these counterfeiters, but on the other hand, if we increase the penalties, I want to make sure that that's going to have a deterrent effect. And, you know, I have a background before I came to Congress in criminal law. And one thing is that penalties don't deter people unless they think there's a likelihood that they might get caught. So I want to ask you, under the current system, if Congress just increased penalties and did nothing else, would that solve the problem?
Yeah, I think, obviously, penalties are an important step in the process. And let me agree with you, Ranking Member DeGette, and particularly single out one penalty that's particularly low. Foreign unapproved drugs, which pose the same public health risk as a counterfeit drug, they could be...
Yeah, I understand. I'm sorry, I don't have very much time. So if we increase those penalties, do you think that would deter people from counterfeiting those drugs?
I think it would increase the frequency in which those cases are investigated. I think it would increase the frequency which...
Because prosecutors would take it more seriously.
Yeah, and it would increase the penalties.
Thanks. Now, do you think the problem of counterfeit drugs has gotten worse in recent years?
Yes, and more sophisticated.
And what new methods are the counterfeiters using to evade detection?
They are more effectively hiding their money around the world, and they're more effectively using websites around the world, hundreds and hundreds of rogue websites linked together. They resemble international organized crime, and they're using the tools of it.
Okay. And that's why you think we need more serious investigation
yes.
and prosecution.
It's hard to prosecute an international
organized. They're going to be more sophisticated on that end. We've got to be more sophisticated. Can you talk to us for a minute about the Office of Drug Security Integrity and Recalls, about when the office was created, what its mission is, and has it been successful in addressing these supply chain threats?
Yeah, the Office of Drug Supply Integrity and Recalls is part of the Center for Drugs Office of Compliance, which I used to be director of. That office, ODSERS is called, was created in 2011, I believe. And the part it plays in this is, one, it's the office charged with implementing the track and trace aspect of the DQSA. And number two, when we have a counterfeit incident, part of it is law enforcement, part of it is public health notification.
Right.
So when we have an incident like with Avastin a couple of years ago, ODSER sent out 1,500 letters to the medical community that note, here's a drug that you have that you think is Avastin that's a counterfeit to protect patients, and also works to educate the
medical community. So do you think it's working, or could it be working better?
I think it's working quite well, and of course we always want it to work better as the problem.
And what could you do to make it work better?
We would, and are putting more resources into the problem, and we think working on implementing track and trace and further educating the medical community
will help. Okay, will help. And I want to talk for a minute. I'd love to yield to my friend, Mr. Dingell.
Microphone. Just so people could hear, his microphone wasn't on. He's asking if you could submit to the committee what changes we could you would suggest that we make.
We would be glad to.
Good.
Thank you. Now, I want to talk about resources for a minute, because this FDA report that the chairman referenced in his opening statement says that the FDA is inspecting the foreign sites once every 9 years, compared with the domestic sites every 2 years. Is that because of a lack of resources, Mr. Sklamberg?
That was a relic of the way the drug industry looked years ago. Fidasia has
No, but I mean, why only 9 years? Once every 9 years? Is that because of a lack of resources to do it?
That was the difficulty and expense of foreign inspections and the logistics.
So your answer is yes?
It is more challenging to do foreign inspections than domestic ones.
So what would the FDA need to do more frequent inspections? Would you need more resources to do that?
As we've gotten more resources,
we're
able to increase the foreign inspections. It obviously.
So do you have enough resources to do these foreign inspections at the regularity you think you need to do them?
We found that as the resources have increased with user fees, generic drug user fees, we've been able to increase it. So there is a direct relation.
So answer my question, please. Do you have enough resources to be able to do these inspections with the regularity you think you need to do them?
We have the resources to do them now. The thing is, the situation is going to grow and grow and grow in the future as the percentage.
But you may not have the resources in the future.
We'd have to evaluate that in the future, but the situation is growing.
Okay, thank you. I yield back.
Chairman yields back. Now recognize Vice Chair of the full committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you all for being with us today. And as you can see, it's an issue that we are all quite concerned about. Mr. Sklamberg, CSIP, are you familiar with Center for Safe Internet Pharmacies?
I am.
Okay. Talk a little bit about who they are and how you're working with them, and just for the audience so that they will know, this is a group that is working Google, GoDaddy, IPEC, IPEC, and trying to root out and keep some of these rogue websites
out.
And I'd love to hear how you're interfacing with them, because it seems as if they, as an industry, voluntarily are seeing some results.
Yes, what we do with CSIP and with other folks in industry, be they credit card companies and others, is when we obtain information about a counterfeit or when industry does, they report it. Now, it's important that for example, if it's a website, that the website be taken down. If it's a credit card company, that the credit account be disabled.
Right.
That's challenging.
Right. And payment processors. The disabled
and paper processors
account,
as well.
They have to participate with it. Has Google using the AdWords program to permit only U.S.-based online pharmacies, has that been helpful?
Well, Google, as you know, entered into an agreement a couple of years ago where they forfeited $500 million because of the AdWords program had let in Canadian unapproved drugs. As a result of that, Google has been cooperating with us in our efforts.
All right. I think all of us have a tremendous amount of concern about the rogue websites and the rogue pharmacies and the damage that it does, and also the phishing and the data security issues. You know, it is just a really sticky ball of wax. So I'm pleased to know that you are working with them and that you all are information sharing. Do you have the right authority to share information back and forth, or is there some changes that we should make to allow that?
We have authority, but one of the things that's difficult is, just as an example, with internet service providers who are, you know, want to be cooperative with us. So we have all these websites. Right now, we have to get grand jury subpoenas to obtain information that they want to give to us about internet service providers. We don't have an administrative subpoena authority targeted even to just internet service providers. That's incredibly time-consuming and cumbersome for the assistant United States attorney who would get the case, and then for us, and it slows us down.
Okay.
We have to get court orders for some of her actions, subpoenas from others. And there would be a series of tools that we could get that would make these investigations move more quickly. And since we're dealing basically with organized crime, and that's what it is, organized crime using medicine, fake medicine, we have to have tools that are as fast as the criminals are.
So as we look at data security and privacy issues, we need to review the elements that would allow you greater access and speed.
That
a little bit of clarity.
I think that would help.
Okay. Just as I have a little bit of time left, the botulinum issues. And I know everybody thinks in terms of just Botox, but of course some of my researchers at our facilities in Tennessee, migraines, Parkinson's, cerebral palsy for children, and they're using the drug there. And I know you all have had some processes in place dealing with the unlicensed suppliers of the botulinum and also your secure supply chain pilot project. I am hopeful that you are seeing companies that are applying for this pilot. How many?
And how many? 12 so far, and the program basically just started, so
and
we're excited about that.
And you can pick up to 100.
That's correct.
Okay, and in what countries are the companies located?
A variety of countries. I
okay.
don't have the information.
Let's
when we get that to you.
Let's just submit that for the record, just for our understanding.
We'd be glad to.
As we go through and monitor it, and I think also we're going to want to look at the successes that you have in analyzing the project, how you're equating the variables, and then what you see as your deliverables from that project as we move forward. But thank you for the update, and I'll yield back, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. We'd be glad to get that to you.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize Mr. Waxman.
I yield.
The suggestions that you essentially were about to make to my colleague about what it is you need in the way of authority to address the questions that you were just describing.
We would be glad to, sir.
I thank the gentlewoman for yielding.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Waxman is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Schlamberg, Congress has made a number of changes to FDA law in the last year and a half that should help fight counterfeit drugs. For example, the FDA Safety and Innovation Act increased the maximum prison time to 20 years for knowingly and intentionally selling a counterfeit drug or knowingly and intentionally alterating a drug such that it has a reasonable probability of causing serious harm or death. And the Drug Quality and Security Act sets up a track and trace system that over the next 10 years should make it increasingly difficult for criminals to introduce counterfeit drugs into the drug supply. Can you tell us how useful these new laws have been?
They have been quite useful, but of course they don't solve the entire problem. I'll take track and trace as an example, which we want to thank this committee for its work on. Track and trace works when you have folks in the supply chain who want it to work. You know, who want to look and see, is this legitimate product that I'm dispensing or that I'm getting? What it doesn't do is stop a couple of unscrupulous people or criminals who want to have a transaction together where they're selling a crooked product. So if you have a person outside the legitimate supply chain selling to someone, another person outside the legitimate supply chain, administering it to somebody, that's not what track and trace is intended for. And track and trace, you know, wouldn't stop that. The increased penalties in FDASIA, Congressman Waxman, that you mentioned, are useful, but there is still a major gap, and this is the foreign unapproved drugs. And they are as dangerous as counterfeits, but you can sell, in a criminal case, and I used to be a prosecutor, and one of the hard parts of it is you have to prove what the person did and the mental state. So to get the counterfeit penalties, you have to prove that the person knew it was a counterfeit, that they were selling. And you have a conspiracy involving, could be dozens of people, hundreds of people, conceivably. We're not going to be able to arrest all of them. So you may be able to show that, for example, it's a foreign unapproved drug and not a counterfeit. If you sell a foreign unapproved drug and the government can't prove fraud, which would often be the case, because it's not purporting to be the U.S. drug, it's a foreign unapproved drug, and a person gets sick and dies, that's a misdemeanor, even with the changes that were made over the last couple of years. So you're selling a dangerous product that causes a death, and the criminal penalty under federal law in that situation would be a misdemeanor. Now, if there's fraud, the penalties go up under the Food, Drug, Cosmetic Act. There's also mail fraud, wire fraud, other statutes. But we have, you know, that gap.
I also mentioned in my opening statement that if you prove an intent to violate the law, which is necessary before you can win a criminal case for drug counterfeiting, that even if we win, the maximum penalty for some violations with potentially life-threatening consequences is only 3 years. Isn't that correct?
It's under the Food, Drug, Cosmetic Act for fraud, it would be three. For counterfeit, specifically for counterfeit, it's higher.
Mm-hmm.
But again, counterfeit versus foreign unapproved from a public health consequence, there is really not much of a difference.
So these, what impact do these weak penalties have on our ability to deter drug counterfeiting?
They do significantly. I mean, even at the front end, so when a case is presented to a prosecutor, a federal prosecutor who has, 200 other investigations and they have narcotics conspiracies, public corruption, fraud, they're looking at this. It's not an area of law they've seen before. And if an agent comes to them and says, here's a case, and they're looking and they'll say, like, well, the penalty is 1 year or 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I can do an investigation for take 2 years, put the other cases in the back of my file cabinet. And as I look at the federal code, and the federal code is, Congress's priority for the crime. It's 3 years, the penalty that was in place since 1938. Rationally, that prosecutor is going to look at this and say, should I prioritize this? And I'm not faulting that prosecutor. That would have been my calculus.
Mm-hmm.
And it affects the whole system and kind of what drives the priorities in the whole system.
Well, as my colleagues have mentioned, we need your recommendations for what additional tools you need to help prevent these kinds of actions and to discover such actions and to punish these actions. So we'll look forward to getting further recommendations from you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Chairman.
Thank you. And anticipating Mr. Dingell's question, details of that to this committee would be most welcome of all those processes Mr. Waxman asked for.
And my answer is the same. We'd be glad to.
Thank you. I'm learning from the master. We only have a few months left of him, so we're all trying to learn from him. So I now recognize the vice chair of the committee, Mr. Burgess, Dr. Burgess, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Klamberg, I just really want to underline the point you just made, because on the penalty aspect, there's the deterrent, and then from a prosecutor's perspective, there's the priority. And we are damaging ourselves on both sides. We're not really providing a deterrent to the criminal. And then on the other side, we're not really prioritizing it or giving that impetus to the prosecutor. Did I understand you correctly?
That's correct, Dr. Burgess.
And you think that changing that certainly would alter the priority from a priority standpoint at the prosecutorial level?
It would make it easier for FDA to present those cases to prosecutors, yes.
Now, I do want to also go back to something that Ms. DeGette was saying on the whether or not you have the funding that you need to inspect foreign sites. My understanding with the user fee agreement that was reauthorized in 2012, that we gave you, the FDA, the authority, you go where you need to go. You stay as long as you need to stay. Is my understanding correct?
That's correct. I mean, the one thing that we did in the last round of the user fee negotiations is went to a goal of parity of foreign and domestic inspections. So our foreign inspection numbers go up every year, and they're going to, move up to get into line with what the reality is. And, of course, in the next round of user fee negotiations, I'm sure we'll look at what funding would be appropriate at that time.
And I also presume that during that time you will provide the committee with feedback as to the utility of that flexibility, which the law, the committee, enabled you to have the last time this was reauthorized.
Yes, that we would do that.
Now, I will also point out, it's probably prior to your time with the agency, but Mr. Sharfstein came to this committee in 2007 or 2008, and in response to that same question, perhaps asked by another member, his answer was, we have everything we need. So, look, I've been on this committee for 10 years. I understand how this threat has changed, how the globalization of our economy has, in fact, affected your ability to do your work within our shores. So I appreciate the fact that it is an evolving process. But as Mr. Dingell has pointed out, we need your feedback so that we can help you keep up with the threat as it emerges. No one knew back in 1998, when some of these stories were first being written, the degree to which it would evolve today.
Yes, and that's why, you know, when we have the reauthorization of the user fees, I'm sure, you know, FDA and the committee will be engaged.
But don't wait.
Right.
Don't wait. Let us know along the way. Now, Ms. Blackburn was talking, and I didn't realize this. You have an agreement with Google about online pharmacies?
There was, I believe it was in 2011, Google entered into a non-prosecution agreement where they forfeited $500 million. And as part of that, they established a compliance program.
Well, I don't want to speak out of school, but I just typed in cheap Viagra to Google, and you get a lot of sites. Now, the house server won't let me go to any of them, but just so you know, it's right. I'm not sure that's working all that well. You might want to check it out when you get to a non-house server location. I do need to ask you this. We, in 2008, this subcommittee had a big investigation on, it was an active pharmaceutical ingredient in the drug thinner heparin imported from China.
Right.
And it had been contaminated with a product called hypersulfated chondroitin sulfate, if I recall correctly. And this product that was adulterating the heparin not only didn't thin the blood, it killed the patient. So it was a real troublesome aspect of that contamination. I don't feel like we've ever received the resolution of that we should have. So can I just ask you today, from the FDA's perspective, is this still an open and ongoing investigation, or have we just simply said we're never going to get to the bottom of this?
I believe I would have to get back to you, Dr. Birds, if I may, on that. I believe there's an aspect of it that is open, but I want to make sure about that. And I know committee counsel has been engaged with FDA on this issue.
And I would just make the point again that this molecule, hypersulfated chondroitin sulfate, was actually patented in China. I believe this was criminal intent before the act occurred, and as a consequence, American patients were killed. And, you know, it's from the perspective of a physician, you know, you think of somebody in a dialysis center flushing the line with heparin in a dialysis patient, and they died right after that. I mean, that's something they're going to have to live with for the rest of their lives. So this is not a small and inconsequential thing. We make jokes about Viagra, but this was a terribly significant event in the lives of patients and physicians and nurses across this country. I really don't want to see us not resolve this problem. So, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for the time, and I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Now recognize Mr. Dingell for 5 minutes.
Courtesy, and I commend you for this hearing. It's a very important hearing, and I think you have conducted it with extraordinary skill. I want to welcome a little later Dr. Prashant Yadav, who is a constituent of mine from the University of Michigan, who will be testifying on another panel. And I'm sorry I may not be able to be here to hear him. Now, the Congress has taken some remarkable steps under the leadership of this subcommittee and this committee, giving the FDA the authority they need by passing the FDA Safety and Innovation Act, which contained a number of provisions from my Drug Safety Enhancement Act, and most recently the Drug Quality and Security Act. And I think that we can all be proud of what we've done, but as indicated this morning, you pointed out that more can be done. So, answer if you please, yes or no. One of the oldest challenges facing this nation is the globalized nature of our drug supply chain. Commissioner, is it correct that 40% of the pharmaceuticals and 80% of the active pharmaceutical ingredients are made in foreign countries, yes or no?
Yes.
You also have a big problem with some of the raw materials that later go in to some of these pharmaceuticals in their finished form, do you not?
Yes, that's correct.
Do you have the, you can't answer, you don't have time to answer this, but would you submit to us a brief comment as to whether you have authority to get at those people who manufacture and ship these into the United States, and what additional authorities you have need of? Now, the FDA Safety and Innovation Act gave your agency new authorities, such as registration of foreign drug facilities and mandatory detention to help the agency deal with the globalized drug supply chain. Is your authority there sufficient, and what more is required, if you please? but answer that for the record. Now, Commissioner, does FDA need additional authorities to keep Americans safe from counterfeit and substandard drugs that are coming in from abroad? Yes or no?
Additional authorities would help us do the job.
Would you please define in a written response for inclusion in the record what is required there? Now, Commissioner, does FDA have the resources it needs to carry out the new authorities granted to the agencies in the FDA Safety and Innovative Act? Yes or no?
We've found that the additional funding has helped us and has helped us implement statutes like the Asian
Pacific. Would you please submit to us what is needed there? I happen to believe one key reason that counterfeit and substandard drugs are still public health problems in the United States is the penalties are not sufficient to deter criminals from engaging in this activity. We seem to have an agreement on this. I'm wondering if we should make the penalties which we collect be turned over to Food and Drug for additional enforcement. We do that on narcotics. Would this be helpful, and would you submit additional comments on how that would work to assist you with your business?
We'd be glad to.
Now, Commissioner, the maximum penalty, as you mentioned, for these activities is only $10,000 or 3 years in prison. What should it be? And please define that by relating it to other questions involving narcotics and other events which are essentially similar. Would you submit that?
We'd be glad to.
Now, Commissioner, is it correct that a Utah man was recently convicted of shipping over $5 million in unapproved drugs, but received only a one-year prison sentence?
That is correct.
Seems rather contemptible. Now, Commissioner, does FDA support strong civil monetary penalties against those charged with misbranding or counterfeiting drugs, yes or no?
We have in the past, I believe, but we can get back to you on that.
I'd like to have something on the record. This reminds me of some great lines from Gilbert and Sullivan, where the emperor indicated that it was his purpose so sublime to make the punishment fit the crime. And it would seem that this committee might want to do something of that sort today, but with your guidance, I think we can do it. Mr. Chairman and my colleagues, I thank you. You have been very gracious to me this morning.
Thank you for also not singing those lines. We appreciate that. Now recognize Mr. Griffith from Virginia for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate a lot of the questions that have been asked today. Let me ask some questions. I agree that we ought to figure out how we need to do this. In regard to the situation that Mr. Dingell just mentioned in Utah, was the gentleman charged with any other crimes as a part of his scheme?
I don't recall right now. It's 1 second. Or maybe I can get back to you if we can go ahead with another
question. That'll be fine, because the previously, you correctly stated that a lot of times there are other charges that can be brought and that those may carry additional time. And so I guess what I would ask you is that since law enforcement can bring other wire fraud, mail fraud, whatever other charges, are you seeing that prosecutors are looking at that and raising up the priority on these crimes? And do we need to look at raising the penalties, or do we just need to encourage the prosecutors to go forward on all fronts as opposed to just one?
Yeah, I think what's happening, Congressman Griffith, is that when the case is initially presented to the prosecutor, they're not going to know whether they're going to be able to prove the fraud. So if they prove fraud, mail fraud's maximum penalty is 20 years, wire fraud's 20 years. You know, if I sell you a fake Rolex and mail it to you, I'm going to get hammered. But they don't know if they're going to be able to prove that, and that's going to require a lengthy, years-long grand jury.
So that's what discourages the prosecutions.
Up front. Now, they're going to stack the charges right, as best they can if they prove it.
Sure. Now, obviously, you've got a better shot with somebody in Utah of apprehending the individual than you do if they're from some foreign nation. Do you think that there's a better chance of collecting if we raise the penalties or the civil penalties and criminal penalties on the financial side more than the prison time, would that have a greater impact on the foreign import chain?
I think enhancing, for example, asset forfeiture and seizure would make a big effect, because we can then take the money, which would have a big effect, deterrence, and also just reducing the upside of engaging in the criminal activity in the first place.
And I would agree that a lot of times that helps law enforcement in other fields, and maybe this is one of those areas where we need to agree with Mr. Dingell when he said that perhaps we need to see that the enforcement agency gets at least a portion of those funds back to help them go after other bad actors in this area. I do appreciate that. Let me ask you this, because you talked earlier about the prioritization of the various crimes by a prosecutor. If we raise these penalties up, at what point do we then deprioritize something else that we may consider important?
I refer you to the Department of Justice. I mean, obviously that always is a problem. And to a prosecutor, every case is, you know, like their baby. But, these are ones, I think, because they're not common to, prosecutors, a white-collar prosecutor will see mail fraud cases a lot, typical ones. They'll see an odometer rollback case much more than they would see a counterfeit drug case. And so they're not, we'll present the public health risk, and we'll convince them, and we're not saying Department of Justice is not cooperative. They are. It's just the maximum punishments reflects Congress's sense of the priority. And you go to court, you have a trial. We have a case of an oncology, unapproved oncology drugs. There was a trial, I believe, late last year. The person was convicted of over 20 misdemeanors, and they were just misdemeanors. And to, a rational prosecutor, do you want to spend a couple of years investigating what turns out to be a misdemeanor?
Sure. Let me switch gears, and I know it's not your area of jurisdiction, but I would ask you to take the message back. We've been talking about FDA's authority over drug supply chain, the Drug Quality and Security Act. That also had in it an issue of compounded drugs. Again, I know it's not your jurisdiction, but I'm continuing to follow the FDA's regulation activities in that area. I would remind the agency that the DQSA was supposed to preserve the status quo when it comes to compounding drugs for office use and the repackaging of sterile drugs. Unfortunately, we're starting to see some reports that indicate that warning letters are being sent to prohibit these activities by traditional pharmacies, which were going on before we passed the bill, and there was kind of an agreement between the House and the Senate. We'd leave that as a status quo. So I'll just keep, if you take it back, just tell them we'll keep monitoring this, but I am concerned about that.
And okay.
Appreciate the work you're doing here today, and this hearing has been great. Thank you for your testimony, and I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir.
I now recognize Mr. Johnson for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and gentlemen, thank you for your testimony here today. You know, a large percentage of the people that I represent in eastern and southeastern Ohio are seniors, and with often limited and fixed incomes, there are many seniors who struggle with the cost of prescription drugs. And I've heard from some individuals who look to purchasing drugs from Canada as a way to achieve drastic savings on their prescriptions. But I also have concerns about these practices and how to protect seniors from illegal pharmacies that may be distributing dangerous drugs and playing on their need to save. So can you clarify the legality of seniors purchasing drugs either in person or online from Canada in order to achieve savings? Is this a legal practice?
It is not a legal practice.
It is not a legal practice.
It is not legal.
It is not legal. Okay, thank you. Are most internet pharmacies that purport to be in Canada actually not in Canada, or certainly not providing drugs that originated in Canada?
We've found many, many online pharmacies that purport to be Canadian that are not Canadian. And it's a ruse that's used, because a lot of vulnerable Americans and people who are very sick, seniors, they'll think, well, Canada, that's safe. And it turns out it's not Canada. It's someplace like we saw in the videos.
Right, right. Okay. Didn't FDA's Operation Bait and Switch survey show that about 85% of the online pharmacies were not from Canada? Is that true?
I don't know. I don't remember the exact statistic, but the number
is
very high.
Can you verify that back to me, please?
It's correct.
It is 85%. Correct. Okay, great. Like a good lawyer. I'm not a lawyer, but I don't typically ask questions I don't know already the answer to. So
we'll happily add someone with me who didn't know the answer to that. So
thank you. Last year, the FDA worked with international regulatory and law enforcement agencies to shut down more than 1,600 illegal pharmacy websites. Is it true that most of the websites represented themselves as Canadian pharmacies, claiming that the medicines that they sold were FDA-approved or brand-name drugs, which they were not? Is that also true?
I believe that many of them were. I'm not sure if it's a majority. But yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
Quickly, and I apologize to him. This is a very excellent point. Would you submit something for the record so that we have something that would tell us what would assist the gentleman in understanding and help me to understand what is going on? Now I ask you to consent that the gentleman get the time back that I've taken from him.
My pleasure to
We'd
yield,
be glad to.
Mr. Chairman. Even in the instance of an online pharmacy actually being in Canada, haven't some of these internet pharmacies come under criminal investigation?
Correct.
Okay. All right. Well, shifting gears here just for a second, let me see if I can get through this next one. In 2005, five teenage boys from three different states died after ingesting raw DXM powder that they bought in bulk from an online source. All of these tragic deaths were linked to the same internet supplier operating out of Indianapolis, where two men bought the drug in bulk from India, repacked it, and sold it over the internet. Investigators estimated they made $70,000 on sales of the misbranded drug into interstate commerce. This is every parent's worst nightmare. These three incidents have been the subject of scrutiny by this committee in the past when Chairman Upton introduced legislation on the matter in 2009. And I'm proud to continue his work on the matter along with my colleague, Mr. Braley, through the introduction of the PACT Act, which would ensure that only legitimate entities registered with the FDA or comparable state agencies can purchase raw bulk DXM. But there are still questions to be answered. How did these young men obtain this drug online? How easy is it still for teens to purchase bulk drugs online in order to abuse the substances they get?
It is very easy to purchase drugs online, whether it be teens or adults, and teens are better at using the internet than adults.
That's true. How prevalent are similar circumstances to the one I just described? How prevalent are they today in your experience and what you guys are seeing?
Yeah, we don't have a number specifically on teens versus adults, but I would say, you know, it would stand to reason that that problem is prevalent.
And it's growing.
Yeah, as the whole problem is, yeah. I would think so. Again, I don't have stats, but I would think so.
What's being done to protect our nation's young people and crack down on the illegal online drug sales targeting those who aim to abuse the substances?
This would be part of, you know, our larger effort regarding rogue internet pharmacies and foreign unapproved drugs and counterfeit drugs. And obviously, we prioritize more vulnerable victims in how we look at cases. So it'll be part of that effort and obviously a very important part of it.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
I think you now recognize Mr. Long for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today and for your testimony. Mr. Is it Sklamberg?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If we've asked you for a lot of things here today, a lot of questions we have of you, but a question I have for you is, what, if you were going to say the top three things that you need from us, or that you need from Congress? Now, you rolled your eyes, so I don't know what that means. But what can we do to help this dire situation?
No, I wasn't rolling my eyes. I was thinking of how do I pick.
Now, when I first ran for office, my political people said that I did that. They told me not to do that. So.
Oh, okay.
But I still do it.
Well, I've never won an election, so nor run for office. There are a series of things that I think would help us. I mean, one is we talked about increased penalties. We talked about increased authorities.
Let me stop you on that one. I had to step out of the room for a moment, and I don't know if I missed it or not, but what was the upshot of the video we saw, the gentleman on there that had this huge operation and apparently was induced to come to the United States after 7 months of communication. What was the final upshot of that?
I don't remember what the ultimate disposition of the case was. He was arrested and sentenced, but I don't know what the sentence was exactly. 87 months imprisonment.
Okay. I interrupted you. Number one, okay, is larger sentences. Number two.
Yes. Now, that's one where we're able to prove the crimes that have the higher penalties. So ones where, one I'd mentioned before, where we're unable to prove, you know, counterfeit drugs or fraud, then you end up with the misdemeanors. So I think the penalties, I think some of the increased enforcement tools, we talked about, you know, asset forfeiture, we talked about seizure, we talked about authority for us to obtain records that would be useful in these cases. I think that for us, we're working with our foreign regulatory partners to enhance international cooperation. So that's more something that FDA is doing, because as this international organized crime activity grows, that's something.
Are we getting more cooperation?
We have to do from certain locations. It's sporadic, and you know, as I'd mentioned, I think to one of your colleagues, international organized crime is clever, and so they're going to situate themselves in places that have minimal cooperation with the United States, which makes detection harder, and then makes investigation and apprehension and punishment harder on the back end. Now, there are lots of countries we have very cooperative relationships with in their law enforcement. And
let us know what we can do to help you in those instances, if you
yes,
will.
Yes, sir.
And I'd like to yield the balance of my time to my friend, Dr. Burgess from Texas.
And thank the gentleman for the time. Mr. Sklenberg, Mr. Kubiak, both of the question to both of you, really an observation. I mean, what is the main driver here? It's the ability to make money. And, of course, we know people make money in illicit drug trade all the time. But in this instance, you can do a counterfeit drug, and no one's shooting at you on the border. So in some ways, it's a safer occupation for someone who wants to work on the wrong side of the law. And then, as you've pointed out, the penalties are not all that great. Prior to the passage of the Medicare Modernization Act in 2003, you did see the news stories of large amounts of seniors getting on buses and going to Canada to shop for their medications. I don't know if you're aware of it, but the Affordable Care Act, which began working one way or another on January 1st, individuals now buying in the individual market, a bronze plan back in my home state of Texas, the deductible is $6,000. So people who have been used to receiving their drugs or medications where something is paid for by the insurance company now find themselves on the hook for a big part of that out-of-pocket expense. Some might even argue they're functionally uninsured when it comes to their prescription drug benefit. Are you prepared? I mean, what is going to be the natural tendency of someone who needs whatever, Crestor, Lipitor, and now they're having to pay the full out-of-pocket freight or the full freight for the cost of that medication? Are they not likely to seek a lower cost on a ready device like their iPad or their laptop?
Sir, yes, I think they are likely to seek that. I think the challenge, though, is they need to understand who they're buying it from, right?
And no quarrel with that, but I don't mean to interrupt you, but the time's about to expire. Are you preparing yourself for the fact that there is the possibility that this type of activity may increase and may increase significantly from a population where historically it hasn't been happening?
Congressman, I think across the board we've been preparing ourselves for an increase in continued growth, unfortunately, in this program and this problem over time. And as we deal with that and deal with these illegal internet pharmacy sites, we are trying robustly through education and also through enforcement to shut down and close out those opportunities to purchase those that are not secure sites.
I'm just not sure you recognize what's coming your way, and I wanted to warn you what's right over the horizon, because people are going to act in their own self-interest when they're faced with those questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields. Yes, Mr. Lee.
Thank you.
I'll tell you what.
I knew there was a catch.
Tell you what, Mr. Chairman, I have one follow-up question, so I'll give you a minute, and I'll give myself a minute, and we'll deal with it.
I'll yield to you, Mr. Chairman. You're more important than I am in this place.
Well, thank you. Let me start with mine, and then I'll yield this to you. I want to ask you, Mr. Kubiak, because this is a follow-up. Are there any legal barriers that constrain you in sharing information with foreign government partners and cooperating with efforts against counterfeit drugs?
Sir, collectively, with all the agencies that are represented at the center, we have quite a broad capability. Individually, each of the agencies have different capabilities to share. So, for instance, within Homeland Security Investigations, ICE, my parent organization, we have the broad ability to share information with our customs counterparts around the world through customs mutual assistance agreements, which are outside of the normal mutual legal assistance treaties that normally are required and that Mr. Sklenberg talked about earlier in the day. We do have very broad authority to share, and combined, I think we have those authorities and those capabilities that we need to do that. I would also suggest, just if I may, that an increase in the minimum mandatory sentence, an enhancement, if you will, for pharmaceutical, for those engaged in the sale of illegal or unapproved drugs would be a significant improvement as well. We see kind of across the board that absent that increase in minimum mandatory sentence, an ability to hold those people more accountable if they're engaged in life-threatening activity would greatly enhance our capability to hold people accountable and also be a major deterrent.
Yeah, two things we'll have to be addressing. One is the severity of punishment, and second is the certainty of punishment. I'll yield a minute to Mr. Dingell.
I think, my friend, has there ever been an international conference on this kind of thing so that we could get everybody together so we could all pull in the same direction?
There have been through a variety of vehicles. The World Health Organization, for example, has been involved in this. There have been.
Would something of this kind be useful again, given the way things are changing? There's an
established mechanism in the World Health Organization to deal with this issue and some other fora. And FDA is pursuing that aggressively.
All right, now, I'm sorry. My next concern here is the hard fact, and that is you have difficulty with the funding of your agency. If you could get the funding of your agency to do as it's done by the drug enforcement people, where the proceeds of the stuff that is used in this could be seized and utilized for either sale so that you could get revenue or so that you could get other helps. Would that be of assistance to you in terms of increasing your levels of funding to deal with these kinds of questions?
I think we could, if I could get back to you on the record for that.
I'd rather have you do that after you had a chance to think about it. Mr. Chairman, you have again been most courteous. Thank you.
The gentleman yields back, and with that, I really want to thank our two distinguished panelists, Mr. Sklenberg, Mr. Kubiak. You've been most helpful in giving us information. We will look forward to getting your follow-up information as soon as you can to this committee so we can take action from there. Thank you.
Thank you.
With that, those two witnesses are dismissed, and I'd like to ask the next set of witnesses on a second panel to come forth. While you're coming forward and taking your seat, I'll introduce the panelists. Dr. Marcia Cross is a director of healthcare at the United States Government Accountability Office. We're also joined by Dr. Prashant Yadav. He's here on behalf of the Institute of Medicine. He is the director of their healthcare research initiative. He is also the director of the William Davidson Institute at the University of Michigan. We also like to welcome Mr. John Clark, who is the vice president and the chief security officer of global security in the compliance division at Pfizer Incorporated. And our other panelist is Mr. Jean-Luc Moreau, the head of product security at Novartis Corporation. Mr. Bruce Longbottom is the Assistant General Counsel at Eli Lilly and Company, and Ms. Elizabeth Youngman is the Director of Drug Safety and Innovation at Pew Charitable Trust. So if the witnesses are ready, I will prepare here to swear all of you in. You're aware the committee is holding an investigative hearing, and when doing so, has a practice of taking testimony under oath. Do any of you have any objections to testifying under oath?
No.
And all the witnesses say they do not. The chair then advised you that under the rules of the House and rules of the committee, you are entitled to be advised by counsel. Do any of the panelists today desire to be advised by counsel during testimony? And all of the panelists say no. In that case, if you'd all please rise, raise your right hand, I'll swear you in. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you. And all the witnesses have answered in the affirmative to that. So now you are all under oath and subject to the penalties set forth in Title 18, Section 1001 of the United States Code. You may now each give a five-minute summary of your written statement. We'll begin with Dr. Kraus for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Chairman Murphy, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the subcommittee, I'm pleased to be here today as you discuss the danger posed by counterfeit drugs. As we've just heard, one source of counterfeit drugs is internet pharmacies. While some internet pharmacies are legitimate businesses that offer consumers a safe, convenient, and cost-effective way to obtain their medications, many are criminal enterprises that defraud consumers and deny patients effective treatments. So-called rogue internet pharmacies often sell counterfeit prescription drugs, sell drugs that have not been approved for sale in the United States, sell drugs that are substandard and have no therapeutic value, and sell drugs that are harmful to consumers. Drugs sold by rogue internet pharmacies have been found to contain too much, too little, or no active pharmaceutical ingredient, or the wrong active pharmaceutical ingredient. Even worse, these drugs may contain dangerous contaminants, such as paint, heavy metals, or poison. Despite the risks, FDA reports that nearly 1 in 4 U.S. adults who shop online have purchased prescription drugs from internet pharmacies. Although the exact number of rogue internet pharmacies is unknown and can change daily, one estimate suggests that there are over 36,000 in operation, up from an estimated 34,000 less than a year ago. Most operate from abroad. They illegally ship prescription drugs into the United States, sell drugs without a prescription, and make efforts to evade scrutiny by customs officials. A recent analysis by NABP, the professional organization for the state boards of pharmacy, shows that 97% of the internet pharmacies it reviewed were out of compliance with laws or industry standards. Rogue internet pharmacies are often complex operations, and federal agencies face substantial challenges investigating and prosecuting those involved. Piecing together their operations can be difficult, because they may be composed of thousands of related websites, and operators take steps to disguise their identities. The ease with which operators can set up and take down rogue websites also makes it difficult for agencies to identify, track, and monitor them, because websites can be created, modified, or deleted in a matter of minutes. The global nature of rogue internet pharmacy operations complicates federal investigations. These websites and their operators are often located in countries that are unable or unwilling to aid U.S. agencies, with components of the operations scattered in several countries. If the clerk would show our first figure, this shows one rogue internet pharmacy that registered its domain name in Russia, used website servers located in China and Brazil, processed payments through a bank in Azerbaijan, and shipped its prescription drugs from India. Rogue internet pharmacies use sophisticated marketing methods to appear legitimate. This makes it hard for consumers to differentiate between legitimate and rogue sites. Some rogue sites seek to assure consumers of the safety of their drugs by purporting to be Canadian, despite being located elsewhere or selling drugs sourced from other countries. They may also fraudulently display an NABP logo on their website, despite not having earned the accreditation. Our second figure, if the clerk would post it, shows a website that may appear to consumers to be legitimate. But the operators of this site pled guilty to multiple federal offenses, including smuggling counterfeit drugs into the United States. Even when such operations are uncovered, the Department of Justice may not prosecute because of competing priorities and the complexity of these operations. Rogue internet pharmacy activity clearly violates the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, but as we've heard, proving violations can be difficult, and violations are subject to relatively light criminal penalties, a maximum of 3 years in jail or a fine of $10,000 or both. When federal prosecutors do pursue such cases, they often charge operators with violations of other laws, such as smuggling, mail fraud, wire fraud, or money laundering, since these violations can be less onerous to prove and carry stronger penalties, up to 20 to 30 years in jail and fines up to $1 million. In summary, while federal agencies have conducted investigations that have led to convictions, fines, and asset seizures, rogue internet pharmacies continue to provide a convenient mechanism for criminals to sell counterfeit drugs or substandard prescription drugs to U.S. consumers with a low probability of being prosecuted. Mr. Chairman, this completes my prepared statement. I'd be happy to respond to any questions that you or other members of the subcommittee may have.
Thank you, Doctor. Now I recognize Dr. Yadav. Am I pronouncing that correctly, sir?
Yes.
Thank you. You're recognized, Prime Minister. Please move the microphone very close to you and make sure the light is on.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Daggett, and members of the committee. My name is Prashant Yadav. I'm the Director of the Healthcare Research Initiative at the William Davidson Institute at the University of Michigan, and I served as a member of the Institute of Medicine Committee on understanding the global public health problem of counterfeit, falsified, and substandard medicines. The Food and Drug Administration had commissioned this study in 2011 to advance what at that time was a stymied public discourse on the topic of pharmaceutical crime. After deliberating and hearing public testimony for most of 2012, our committee released findings and recommendations last year. I was also a member of another committee of the Institute of Medicine, which was on regulatory capacity building in developing countries. This study was also commissioned by the FDA Office of International Programs, and it dealt with questions more broadly on food and drug safety, safety regulation and globalization. I would like to submit for records copies of the two mentioned IOM reports, as well as executive summaries of the two reports and an editorial on this topic. These documents discuss how improving the quality of medicines in this country depends to some extent on better medicines regulation abroad. These reports offer several suggestions as to how different federal agencies and international organizations can work together to improve global drug safety. In my testimony, I'll be using language which is consistent with the IOM report. The members of our committee chose to be clear that we saw two rough categories of dangerous medicines. First, we have falsified drugs, those that carry a false representation of identity or source or both. The other main category is substandard, meaning the medicines that fail to meet our national quality standards. We recognize that often these two categories overlap, but we felt that thinking about these two categories separately helps us characterize the causes of the problems and the solutions for them in a precise manner. We also agreed not to describe the drugs as counterfeit because we felt this term tends to hold back discussion. Many speakers who use the term counterfeit use it to imply something more broad than the legal narrow word counterfeit. The difference in these two meanings can cause confusion and can alienate generic drug companies who sometimes think that this is a means or who view this as hostility to their products hidden in a discussion about counterfeit medicines. So our committee agreed that the problem of trademark infringement was not within our mandate. We attempted to understand the public health problem of poor quality drugs, and we limited our discussions to substandard and falsified or fake medicines. The problem of falsified and fake medicines is undoubtedly worst in the world's poorest countries, but poses a risk for American patients as well. We are living in what The Economist magazine recently described as a golden age for bad drugs. Different drugs and drug ingredients are made in different parts of the world. Final drug formulations may be packaged, repackaged in different countries many times before reaching the final patient. And supervising these supply chains is a monumental task. The committee recommendations were for the US FDA to share foreign inspections and work towards mutual recognition of inspections done by other stringent regulatory agencies. We reasoned that it's simply not good management to have, for example, a Japanese, a European, and a US inspector repeating each other's work when so many factories in places like India and China go uninspected. The key challenge is to identify gaps before product safety emergencies occur. Until recently, the inability to track a package of medicines from the factory to the patient was one such gap. Our committee had asked the Congress to authorize the FDA to establish a mandatory track and trace system in the United States. We were concerned that the FDA has received many unfunded mandates over the years, so we'd also asked the Congress to allocate the appropriate funds to the agency to ensure the staffing and the technology that is needed does exist. This is consistent with the recommendations of the committee and the new act, the Drug Quality and Security Act in November, is very much in tune with what the committee had recommended. I would like to thank the representatives here today for your work on that law. Track and trace legislation is going to help, but there are still many gaps in the supply chain. One of them is the question of internet pharmacies. The IM committee discussed this problem at great length. We reviewed research that says people buy drugs online for different reasons. Some can be described as lifestyle libertarians, who they believe they should be allowed to self-prescribe. Others are bargain hunters who are looking for internet to get deals. And a third category are people who are genuinely trying to buy drugs for making sure they can get them with convenience. These customers do not understand the risk of their choices and do not see any better options. So the committee recommended that the National Association of the Boards of Pharmacies has a program called the Verified Internet Pharmacy Practice Sites, or VIPPS. That program should be strengthened and encouraged. Was one of strong recommendations from the committee. One of the key things the committee recommended was to strengthen the wholesale market in the United States. We felt that there are three kinds of wholesalers. There are primary wholesalers, secondary wholesalers, and wholesalers who are regional drug wholesalers. And it is easy for wholesalers to obtain licenses in one state and engage in commerce without other federal or other states knowing about that.
I need you to summarize because you've gone a minute over.
The committee recommended that FDA should work with state licensing boards and establish a public database to share information on wholesale licenses. This will prevent criminals from licensing in multiple states. On behalf of my colleagues at the committee, I would like to once again thank the representatives for including this provision in the DQSA law. We also believe that strengthening the drug wholesale supply chain will set a good example for other countries in the world.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Clark, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Murphy, Ranking Member Duguette, members of the subcommittee, it's a pleasure to appear before you today to discuss the issue of great importance, the threat that counterfeit medicines pose to the health and safety of patients in the United States and around the world. My name is John Clark, and I'm the Chief Security Officer for Pfizer, Inc., and Vice President of its Global Security Team. Pfizer is a diversified global healthcare company and one of the world's largest biopharmaceutical companies. Our core business is the discovery, development, and marketing of innovative pharmaceuticals for health, human health, and we are committed to ensuring the integrity of those products when they reach the market. I'm responsible for ensuring that programs are in place to protect Pfizer's personnel, real and intellectual property, reputation, and most importantly, the integrity of its medicines. Prior to joining Pfizer in 2008, I served as Deputy Assistant Secretary at Immigration and Customs Enforcement, responsible for the overall management and coordination of the agency's operations. During my more than 25 years in ICE and its predecessor agency, U.S. Customs, I held a variety of investigative, management, and executive positions. A significant aspect of my job at Pfizer is to mitigate the threat that counterfeit medicines pose to the health and safety of patients who rely upon Pfizer medicines to live healthier and happier lives. Counterfeit medicines pose that threat because of the conditions under which they're manufactured in unlicensed and unregulated sites, frequently under unsanitary conditions, and the lack of regulation of their contents. In many instances, they contain none of the active pharmaceutical ingredient found in the authentic medicine or an incorrect dosage, depriving the patient of the therapeutic benefit of the medicines prescribed by their physicians. In others, they may contain toxic ingredients such as heavy metals, arsenic, pesticides, rat poison, brick dust, floor wax, leaded highway paint, and even sheetrock or wallboard, all of which we found in counterfeits. Counterfeit medicines are a global problem, one from which no region, country, therapeutic area, or pharma company is immune. While the true scope of the counterfeit problem is hard to estimate, we can provide some metrics based on the seizures reported to us by enforcement authorities and confirmed by our labs. In reviewing those internal metrics to prepare for today's hearing, I was struck by how significantly the landscape has changed since November 2011 when I appeared before the House Judiciary Committee, just about 2 years ago now. Since November 2011, authorities have reported to us the seizure of more than 55 million dosages of suspicious Pfizer medicines. 28% of those seizures, 15.5 million dosages, were confirmed as counterfeit medicines, and we differentiate. We are very, very conservative in our statistics, and if we haven't confirmed, it's just reported. We don't count it as a statistic, so we're usually underreporting so we don't get accused of exaggerating. The number of Pfizer medicines targeted by counterfeiters has increased by 36% from 50 to 68 different Pfizer medicines now. Counterfeit Pfizer medicines have been confirmed in six new countries: Armenia, Cameroon, Jamaica, Kosovo, Maldives, and St. Lucia, bringing the total to 107 countries in which counterfeit Pfizer medicines have been seized by authorities. Counterfeit versions of 26 Pfizer medicines have been confirmed in the legitimate supply chain of 60 countries, an increase from 22 medicines in 53 countries in November of 2011. Seizures recorded during 2013 reveal that while Viagra, treatment for erectile dysfunction, remains our most targeted medicine for counterfeiters, other medicines have attracted increasing attention, with the seizure of each of the top five exceeding 1 million doses. The seizure of almost 3.6 million counterfeit doses of Viagra represented just 34% of the overall confirmed seizures of Pfizer medicines in 2013, down from 89% in 2012. For the first time, Lipitor, treatment for cholesterol, came in a close second, with the seizure of almost 3.1 million tablets, representing 29% of all confirmed dosage seized. Closing out the top five most counterfeited Pfizer medicines last year were Xanax, 1.3 million, Ponstan, 1.1 million, Centrum, just over 1 million. And again, these are relatively low, probably compared to what was out there, but just the ones we could confirm. The increased counterfeiting of Xanax is likely linked to the popularity, particularly on college campuses, as a party drug often used to decrease anxiety and insomnia. Additionally, Xanax appears to be preferred by individuals taking crystal meth. Counterfeit Xanax seizures in 2013 included those seized from a factory in Texas where 1,000 counterfeit Xanax tablets and tooling were seized by the Drug Enforcement Administration. Despite increased breaches in the legitimate supply chain, the major threat in the U.S. to U.S. patients is the Internet and the many professional-looking websites that promise safe, FDA-approved branded medicines from countries such as Canada and the U.K. In 2006, Pfizer Global Security launched a robust Internet program to identify and disrupt rogue online pharmacies dispensing Pfizer medicines to unsuspecting patients. Although that program resulted in a takedown of several rogue OLPs and arrest, it was in essence a whack-a-mole approach. Recognizing the limitations of that strategy, we sought a broader and more permanent remedy. Along these lines, in 2013, we partnered with Microsoft in an innovative OLP disruption program that attacked the affiliate networks where they were most vulnerable by simultaneously disabling domains to disrupt traffic to the sites and eliminating their ability to process credit card payments for orders placed. This new approach has proven much more effective, evidenced by the disruption of two affiliate networks and the removal of more than 3,300 rogue OLPs from the Internet just last year. To protect unsuspecting patients from the risks of obtaining counterfeit medicines online, we've extended our Internet monitoring program to Craigslist and Facebook, along with other classified advertising websites and social media outlets. As a result of those efforts, we have identified several individuals offering Viagra on Craigslist. Our tech purchases confirmed that these individuals are selling counterfeits. Subsequent referral of these incidents to local law enforcement resulted in the arrest of several sellers, including a Maryland housewife. This social network monitoring also identified several dropshippers for rogue OLPs who use their access to counterfeit medicines to advertise independently on Craigslist. One such referral to police in Toronto resulted in the arrest of six Craigslist sellers.
Mr. Clark, I have to ask you to wind up.
Yeah. And that's it. I will be glad to take questions.
Thank you. I have to step out for a while, and Dr. Burtz will take over, but I just want to ask one clarifying question, Mr. Clark, before I go. If you compare money counterfeiting to electronic counterfeiting to drug counterfeiting, tell me about the different ratios and profitability.
We had 3 years ago seen German Customs refer to a study from the University of Bonn that did just that. For $1,000 base investment by a counterfeiter, they compared what they estimated would be the return on investment. They went through several levels of different commodities. I think cash was the lowest. For $1,000 invested, they estimated that there'd be a $5,000 return on investment for counterfeiting cash. I think credit cards were second with $10,000 return. The second highest level commodity counterfeited for a return on investment was electronics. They estimated for $1,000 investment, the return would be $100,000. The highest on that list by the University of Bonn was pharmaceutical products. For $1,000 invested, they estimated that the return on investment would be $500,000.
Thank you. Incredible. I appreciate that. Mr. Moreau, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, my name is Jean-Luc Moreau, and I'm the Global Head Product Security at Novartis International. My primary responsibility is to protect the company, its products, and most importantly, the patients who rely on Novartis medicines from counterfeits. Modern counterfeiting is an industrial global business which in 2010 generated an estimated $75 billion US dollars for organized crime. In 2002, the Pharmaceutical Security Institute recorded 196 product incidents worldwide. In 2012, the same Pharmaceutical Security Institute recorded 2018 cases, representing a tenfold increase in only one decade. Counterfeit drugs are most of the time extremely dangerous. For example, the World Trade Organization has estimated that counterfeit anti-malaria drugs kill 100,000 Africans annually. My own experience tells me that this number is vastly underestimated. Counterfeit drugs are generally indistinguishable from the genuine drugs. Some examples are displayed on the monitors. Russian counterfeiters have gone so far as to add holograms to the packaging of their fake drugs, which they protected against counterfeit. Counterfeit drugs are made in clandestine facilities which are downright filthy. As the pictures on the monitor show, Novartis products are made in state-of-the-art facilities. By contrast, as the pictures on the screen demonstrate, counterfeiters manufacture their illicit products in decrepit conditions. Counterfeiting operations generally ship and or store their fake products in unsanitary and improper conditions. More examples on the screen. Counterfeiting today is frequently highly organized, transnational, and businesslike. Counterfeiters operate industrial production facilities with the capacity to saturate markets with fake products. They target low-volume, high-specialty medicines, as well as high-volume, low-margin products as over-the-counter drugs or generics. They reach patients directly through the internet or illicit retailers, or they infiltrate legitimate supply chain, as in many countries. The scope of sophistication of this modern counterfeiting is clearly illustrated by the two following examples. First example, in May 2006, customs officers at London Heathrow seized a shipment from Dubai en route to the Bahamas, which contained thousands of packs of 8 confirmed counterfeit drugs from 7 pharmaceutical companies, including more than 3,000 packs of a counterfeit Novartis medicine for hypertension. The counterfeit product had been manufactured in China, transported by road to Hong Kong, flown to Dubai, where they were stored in a duty-free warehouse before being shipped to the Bahamas via the UK. In the Bahamas, an illicit fulfillment center established by RX North, an internet drug website, processed orders placed on the internet by American and Canadian patients. The fake products were shipped directly to the Bahamas to customers in the US and Canada. Second example, Novartis manufactures Coartem, which is a breakthrough drug for malaria. Novartis has made over 500 million Coartem treatments available without profit in malaria endemic countries through programs such as the US President Malaria Initiative and the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria. In March 2010, I organized a market survey in 3 Niger Basin countries, Cameroon, Nigeria, and Benin, which concluded that around 25% of our Coartem donated to Eastern African countries was being stolen and shipped 5,000 miles away to Western Africa, where it was sold on the street, not for free, but an average of $5 per treatment. This large-scale diversion scheme created a mass market for Coartem, which attracted an extensive counterfeiting operation. In July 2012, a container ship from Guangzhou, China to Luanda in Angola was seized by customs officers. It contained Hi-Fi speakers hiding 1.5 million treatments of fake quarantine. Subsequent investigations in Western Africa confirmed that this counterfeit version of Coartem contained nothing but flour, cornstarch, dextrose, and an industrial colorant. There is no question in my mind that the Coartem diversion and counterfeiting schemes have grievously undercut efforts to eradicate malaria and have led directly to the deaths of hundreds of thousands of Africans. The United States and other countries should develop comprehensive body of criminal laws to confront counterfeiting, impose stiffer sanctions for pharmaceutical crimes, and make the commitment to vigorously enforce those laws. Thank you.
Mr. Longbody, recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Madam Ranking Chairman, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Bruce Longbottom. I'm Assistant General Counsel for Trademarks at Eli Lilly and Company. We are a global pharmaceutical manufacturing company based in Indianapolis. And like my colleagues here, our company also invests heavily to research, develop, and produce safe and effective medicines which treat many diseases and save lives. First, let me thank the chairman, ranking member, and members of the subcommittee for your focus on this important issue and for inviting Eli Lilly to testify today about fighting counterfeit drugs and illegal supply chains. We do appreciate the attention you're devoting to investigate the problem of counterfeit medicines, which pose an ongoing risk to patient safety. And this threat of counterfeit medicines is an issue that is near and dear to Lilly and to also the heart of our CEO, Dr. John Lechleiter, who has spoken on this on several occasions. Now, at Lilly, like the other companies here, we have seen counterfeit copies of our own branded medicines around the world, and we've seen counterfeiters target a range of medicines, from our medicines for mental illness to our medicines for cancer as well. Some of the medicines that are fake may contain an over amount, an excess amount of the API, the active pharmaceutical ingredient, or perhaps contain the wrong APIs or none at all. Some counterfeit drugs contain toxic, dangerous ingredients, and we are not alone in this experience. Again, as heard already today, we view this as a global health threat that we must work diligently to solve with others in partnership. We would like to congratulate this committee for its hard work in passing the Drug Quality Security Act of 2013, or DQSA. That new law's establishment of a track and trace system for pharmaceuticals will serve greatly to close gaps in the supply chain for prescription drugs in the traditional supply chain, which is from the legitimate manufacturer to the wholesaler to the pharmacies and then to patients. But while DQSA establishes important requirements for good guys, I believe today's hearing is to look at the bad guys, and as such, I'll focus my remarks today on the most common way that counterfeit drugs reach U.S. patients, and that is, of course, through the internet. A topic already mentioned several times today, and rightfully so, I would add. Obviously, more and more of us are becoming more comfortable with purchasing products online. We are very easily doing that, and e-commerce is projected to grow at over 10% every year. And as more and more Americans do look online for their medicines, and there have been some examples even in this hearing this morning of looking online for medicines, what are we finding? 40 to 50,000 active illegal online drug sellers. And 97%, according to the National Association of Boards of Pharmacy, do not meet pharmacy and drug safety standards. So tens of thousands of fake online pharmacies put patients at risk. Now, is that okay? Of course not. I think no one here is satisfied with that. We don't want to stay at that position. When we interact with a pharmacy, what should we be expecting as we go to a pharmacy, whether in the real world or online? I think there are two basic things. One is a drug approved by the FDA, and the second is a pharmacist who's been licensed by their state pharmacy board. So that prescription medicine has been blessed by the FDA, and that pharmacist has been blessed by the state licensing authority. And I would like to coin the term, if I could, the sanctity of the pharmacy. I think that is the standard that we should work towards, whether in the real world or online. With regard to the online world, there is no one easy bullet to take care of the problem. There's no one easy solution. There are several elements that are critical to adding towards that solution. And there are more details in my submitted written materials, but just at the very high level, some of those themes are patient education, stronger laws, more aggressive enforcement of existing laws, and also voluntary cooperation by internet-based companies. Now, just as the DQSA used one tool primarily to tighten defenses in the brick-and-mortar supply chain, and that tool was, of course, serialization, I believe there are one or more tools that could also be used to tighten the illegitimate supply chain, the online supply chain. And one of those tools I'd like to mention is delisting. That is a tool that could be used to exclude these bad, illegal, rogue online pharmacies from natural search results found using search engines. In other words, if a website selling medicines did not sell only FDA-approved drugs or did not provide those services using a state-licensed pharmacist, you would not find that website in the search results after it was delisted. The online pharmacy would still be on the internet, probably hosted in a foreign country, but it would not be found by the patient in the U.S. doing an internet search. If natural search results were cleaned up in this way, that would be the internet equivalent, I believe, of what the DQSA has done to tighten the traditional supply chain. And there are other tools that could be discussed as well. Search optimization for the NABP-approved pharmacies may be another helpful tool to boost those in the search rankings. The internet is here to stay. The number of fake online pharmacies is growing, and Eli Lilly and Company stands committed to patient safety in both the brick-and-mortar pharmacies and the internet-based pharmacies. And I very much appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Ms. Youngman, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Chairman Murphy, Ranking Member, Chairman Murphy, Ranking Member DeGette, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to present testimony. My name is Elizabeth Youngman. I direct safety and drug safety and innovation work at the Pew Charitable Trust.
Let me ask you, is your mic on?
Pardon me. My name is Elizabeth Youngman. I direct drug safety and innovation work at the Pew Charitable Trust, which is an independent, nonpartisan research and policy organization dedicated to serving the public. Counterfeit drugs are far more than an intellectual property problem. They are a public health problem with real human cost. Counterfeit and other unsafe drugs have entered our drug supply numerous times over the past few decades. Three recent incidents of fake cancer drugs are one example. My testimony for the record and our website have others. I am grateful to Congress for recently enacting two important laws that have been discussed by other panelists, Title VII of the FDA Safety and Innovation Act, which focused on upstream supply chain security, and Title II of the Drug Quality and Security Act, which laid the groundwork for tightening the downstream drug distribution system. My testimony today will focus on next steps, how policymakers and stakeholders can make full use of these new tools. Meaningful penalties for drug counterfeiting and diversion are important, but the best way to prevent unsafe products from reaching patients is a tightly closed distribution system, so that is my focus today. By passing the Drug Quality and Security Act last year, Congress created a national serialization and traceability system that will fundamentally change drug distribution in this country. Beginning in late 2017, each package of prescription drugs will bear a unique serial number, enabling it to be verified and eventually allowing for its distribution history to be traced. The DQSA contains some requirements for companies in the supply chain to check serial numbers, but in most cases only when there's an existing belief that the product is suspect. A more powerful use of serial numbers would be as a routine proactive check. Counterfeiters can be sophisticated, but falsifying a serial number is much harder if that number is routinely checked against a manufacturer's database. Pharmacists, physicians, payers, and border agents could use this important new tool to help stop fake products from reaching patients. It is important to underscore that the risks go beyond counterfeit drugs. In 2009, thieves stole a tractor trailer containing at least 120,000 vials of insulin, an injectable drug that must be refrigerated. After several months, the stolen drugs were sold to chain drugstores. We don't know how many patients received compromised medicines, but only a small percent of the drugs were ever recovered. Regular checking could have identified them immediately. Verification should become routine in pharmacies. To achieve that, the system must be designed to ensure that verification is practical and efficient. Waivers of the DQSA's requirement should be rare, lest we exempt businesses like the pharmacists in Chicago indicted last year for substituting Chinese counterfeits for legitimate products. Patients can also make use of this new tool. Doctors who purchased the counterfeit cancer drug last year may not have known that it was fake. While the DQSA does not require physicians to check serials, patients deserve this safety check. Physician societies and payers should consider the potential for authentication to protect patients. Proactive verification of serial numbers is not without precedent. Other countries like Turkey and Italy already use it to protect their citizens and to prevent fraud. The U.S. is behind the curve in this case, but our law creates the tools that are necessary for similarly robust protections if Congress, regulators, and payers take action to encourage them. Payers could also explore the use of serial numbers as a condition of reimbursement, both to ensure product legitimacy and to reduce fraud. Large-scale fraud against government programs is well documented, yet preventable through serial checks.
To be fully effective, such an approach would require another system element not explicitly contemplated by the DQSA, decommissioning serial numbers so that they cannot be reused. Serial numbers could also be used by agents at the border. Spot checks of incoming products could help determine legitimacy, and this would complement the progress in regulating drug imports that was made in the 2012 FDA Safety and Innovation Act. The DQSA requires in 10 years an electronic interoperable system for tracing each unit of medicine. There is an opportunity now to build in strong features that will allow for more comprehensive automated use in the future. But stakeholders do not have to wait 10 years to begin using the DQSA. Starting next year, FDA will stand up a public database of licensed wholesalers, and all stakeholders will pass pedigree information. So, long before the law is fully implemented, dispensers can check to ensure that their sources are legitimate. The DQSA and the FDA Safety and Innovation Act are important steps in securing our pharmaceutical supply chain, but alone they will not solve the problem. Congress, regulators, border agents, and supply chain stakeholders can help create a safer drug supply by supporting robust implementation of these laws and full use of the tools that they provide. Thank you.
Thank you, and I thank the witnesses, each and every one of you, for your testimony. We'll now move to questions. Each member will be recognized for 5 minutes. I'll begin. Dr. Cross and Dr. Yadav, appreciated your testimony. You heard my questions to the FDA and to ICE. I mean, cost is a big driver here, and people are looking at pharmacy bills that they have may never have seen before. I got a feel that there is right over the horizon. This problem is going to crescendo in size. One of you referenced the people who go online because they're bargain hunters or they're self-prescribing. Self-prescribing means you're avoiding a doctor visit to get a prescription. So basically, cost is the driver there. Has there been any study on, say, one of the popular proton pump inhibitors for acid reflux disease went over the counter? Did you see a drop-off in internet activity with the purchase of other brands that remained on patent and were therefore more expensive? Was cost reflective in the internet activity?
I'm not aware of any studies that have directly addressed that. We certainly do know that activity has increased across time in general, and the number of sites, I think, reflects that. Internet purchases originally were focused more in the so-called lifestyle drugs. That's moved increasingly into individuals seeking to save money, on their blood pressure medicine or whatever other medications they may regularly be on. But I don't know of studies that have specifically looked at that change when something goes from prescription to over-the-counter.
And Dr. Yadav, did the Institute of Medicine do any of that sort of investigative work?
So the short answer is no. I think that we looked at various studies, and I think we will submit to the committee some of the findings which show which therapeutic categories were being purchased more, what kinds of factors and root causes were leading to that. But there was no study which showed how does this change when a product goes from being prescription to over-the-counter.
Do any of our representatives from the industry have any experience with that? Well, Mr. Clark, just notice on your website some of the things you have in the pipeline, the phase 3 and phase 2 drugs. I mean, some pretty exciting stuff right on the horizon, PCSK9 and for lipid control. Are the development of those products in any way going to be impacted by the fact that the diversionary activities that you described are going on? Is that going to have a direct effect on your research and development side?
It could, and it's one of the worries we've had in rolling out just last year some of the newer medicines. They need a track record to build up success and to prove to the world how good they are. We went out ahead of several of them to start checking the internet and the B2B sites, the OLP sites, to see if in terms of Eliquis, Xeljanz, a few others that were coming out, worried that, if competed with by counterfeits, and there's reports of they don't work because of the counterfeit effect, it could impede actually the reputation of the medicine themselves and stuff. Fortunately, the ones we've been looking at so far haven't had that much competition on the internet.
How about, does it affect, for any of you, does it affect your R&D budget, the fact that you're obviously losing sales?
I can speak for my shop. We separate. We've never been held to task by the company for, you know, return on investment for sales. You know, they really do. It's a reputational thing, which obviously has a collateral, you know, sales impact, but it's really a patient health and safety issue for us.
The very same at Novartis.
And Mr. Moreau, but your description of the antimalarial drug, I mean, United States taxpayers spend a lot of money in the PEPFAR program to buy the drug, prevent the disease, to save the children in other countries, and human tragedy because of the counterfeit drugs making it into the pipeline, and the American taxpayers being ripped off. I mean, this is something that just absolutely has to be stopped, and we certainly appreciate your vigilance to that, and we'll welcome your input back to the committee.
Yes, Congressman. On a more positive note, I just want to inform the committee that we've been working and we're still working very closely with federal agents attached to USAID on this case, and there are reasons to believe that the criminal gang responsible for this counterfeiting operation will one day or another be arrested in China.
All right, very well. And Mr. Longbottom, you heard my description of the little research project I did here on the committee dais, where I Googled, or I'm sorry, I put into a search engine a name of a cheap pharmaceutical project. I got a lot of results, a lot of hits. And then you talked about delisting, and are those types of activities actually in process where you're working with the search engines to try to minimize this?
We are currently developing a web monitoring program, especially here in the States, and with the plan to liaise directly with authorities and exchange information and intelligence.
All right, thank you. Mike.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yep, thank you. We are not currently working on those tools, but I do know that the Center for Safe Internet Pharmacies, or CSIP, referred to earlier by another committee member, is at work to develop proposals to work together. And those are the e-commerce companies, the search engines, the payment card companies, the domain name registrars. So it might come out of that group. But wouldn't it have been nice if you had done the search, the first 35 results would have been the NABP certified online pharmacies. I think that's where we really want to move to. I'd love to see that for my family members going online, constituents as well. I think that's where we're headed.
Absolutely. My time has expired. Recognize the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank all of you for coming here today and working collaboratively with us to try to resolve this very difficult and international problem. I'm concerned because we've recognized this issue of counterfeit drugs. We've been trying to work on it assiduously with the track and trace legislation, with the FDA giving more resources, with all of the private companies giving more resources. But yet, according to the testimony that I'm hearing from all the witnesses today, the prevalence of these counterfeit drugs, particularly on the internet, just continues to grow and to get more sophisticated. And so what I'd like to examine in just this short period of time I have is what we can really do to try to bend this curve and to solve the situation. So I'd like to start with you, Dr. Cross. You testified, as did the others on the last committee, that the sentences are really ridiculously low for these federal offenses. And I agree with that. I think the sentences need to be increased. But I'm trying to figure out, and this is what I was talking to the chairman about, is how much is increasing sentences really going to prevent this kind of conduct, especially as Mr. Moreau and Mr. Longbottom and others have testified, some of these people are renegade gangs in foreign countries. And so one thing I want to ask you, did the GAO find that these prosecutors who were able to prosecute people under other statutes, money laundering, wiretap, et cetera, would there have been more prosecutions and more convictions if they had been able to get felony convictions and higher sentences?
We did hear from prosecutors that increasing the penalties or clarifying what was required to meet a threshold for criminal activity might make this a higher priority among all of the competing cases that they have. If they're having to pick something that's really difficult and that carries low penalties, it has a lower priority.
And so even though they have these other statutes they could charge them, this would help.
They indicated that it would be helpful.
Okay. And it's but it alone would not help. We're going to need to do other things, right?
That's correct.
Okay. And what would some of those other things be?
Well, there have been a number of settlements that have been undertaken to get at some of the service providers to these internet sites. With the Google settlement was mentioned earlier. All that did, though, was remove the sponsored links at the top of the page. That doesn't eliminate
those. So internet
those.
Vigilance, like Mr. Longbottom and others have been talking about, would be helpful.
That could be helpful. Also, the NABP is engaged in getting a top-level domain name, a .pharmacy, where there would be controls in place on which websites could have a .pharmacy extension as opposed to a .com. That would require educating consumers to go to those links and not others.
And let me follow up on that, educating consumers. Mr. Clark, I was actually talking to you yesterday about this. It seems to me one of the real keys is educating consumers that they shouldn't be going on these websites. Can you describe for me what kinds of efforts the industry is taking to do that consumer education?
Sure. I know from our experience, and my colleagues have done similarly, I mean, you know, we're always working with media to try and highlight issues, whether it's a case or just background information, speaking at conferences. We do a lot of training of law enforcement along the same lines to educate them, because I think it's not only just the consumers. First and foremost, it is the medical community. I mean, it's astounding how doctors and nurses aren't still familiar with this, and law enforcement as well. So there's a huge outreach by most of the companies to try and get to all of the constituents within those sectors and stuff to try and raise awareness.
Are you also working with the various federal agencies to increase this education?
Absolutely.
The FDA and the, okay. Now, I wanted to ask you, Ms. Jungman, I'm the co-chair of the Diabetes Caucus, so I was horrified to hear your insulin example. And you talked a lot about, what you really focused on is what more can we do. Does Congress need to do anything to help improve this serial number issue? Because that sounded like a very intriguing and relatively successful way to help to identify these counterfeit drugs.
I think that Congress definitely could have a role here. I think oversight as the system is implemented, both to ensure that all stakeholders are fully participating, but also to be sure that as the system architecture is built up, there are ways that the system could be built that are more robust or just bare bones. And I think congressional oversight could play a real role in ensuring that it's built to have the functionality that would allow for serial checking in a way that's automatic and simple for people to use.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And if you can help convey with me to Mr. Murphy that we should continue this oversight, I think that would be great.
And thank you, gentlelady. Be willing to go for one supplemental question if you were.
Okay, one.
Well, it just so happens I have one. Has the Ryan Haight Act been effective in reducing the number of internet pharmacies selling controlled substances, Dr. Cross?
DEA tells us that it has been effective in reducing the number of domestically located websites selling controlled substances. However, they haven't been doing a lot of looking overseas. They have had a small sample of websites that they looked at and ordered controlled substances, and 40% of the websites where they placed those orders actually provided them with controlled substances. They tell us, though, that they are more likely to be Schedule 3 or Schedule 4, drugs like Vicodin or Xanax, rather than oxycodone, which is a Schedule 2 substance, so that they do believe it's been effective in pushing the activity offshore.
Fair. Recognize the ranking member for an additional question. Yeah, and I would be bipartisan. I would join in that thanks for all the witnesses, all the members who've participated in today's hearing. Remind members they have 10 business days to submit questions for the record. and I ask all the witnesses to agree to respond promptly to written questions. With that, the subcommittee shall stand adjourned. Thank you.